Alright guys, welcome back to the Barcast podcast. I'm Salt.
And I'm George.
And we're here to tell you all about, well, we got three things to tell you about. A quick recap of Barfit. We want to touch on Coast to Coast today, as well as I've been hearing rumors about 24-hour race, George. So all three of those things we want to touch on in this podcast. So let's start right where we want to start, which is down Barfit.
Yeah. I want to first start by saying that I bought this camera ever since. And this is the first time we're using it to actually record the podcast. I think that I've been a little bit paralyzed by equipment.
Right.
I want this equipment. I want this mic and the next thing and third. And all the mentors tell you, just start doing something and get it up. Don't try to be perfect. So we're getting this done.
We're treating this as a late bar. We're going to just get better and better all the time with
correct.
The podcast.
Correct.
So you got a little logo, guys.
Yeah. So we welcome your feedback. Tell us if you're out there, you're techie, and you know, you tell us how to improve. We would definitely appreciate it. But yeah, let me talk about Barfit.
Yeah.
All right. So Barfit, as some of you may know, was really a very spontaneous event. Mm-hmm. I was at Gorhill Playing Field teaching a Barfit class.
And before it was even called Barfit, I was still...
No, Barfit was the program. We introduced this program. We took all of our award classes off the schedule and made the transition into what we call Barfit as a way of bridging the gap between the kind of functional training and the outdoor obstacle course racing.
Right.
So we knew that there were people out there who wanted to do something functional, but they weren't necessarily good at the skills.
Right.
And we didn't want the skills to hold them back. So we were using the sandbags, we were, you know, using other implements, but not including the skills.
Skills better than rigs.
The rigs and multi bars. Yeah, all the things that people just feel. So we put this on the schedule, and I had one class at Gorhill Playing Field on a Saturday morning because I like the outdoor thing and I like to have that space to work with.
Yeah.
So while I was there, I looked at the freshly marked track and all the space, and I was like, you know, I could do something with this, you know.
Right.
And I had an idea for this, how this thing could work. This was a Saturday morning.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Dr. Mohammed of Cure Oxygenated Water,
yeah,
we had met and we had discussed Bar briefly, and I knew he was looking for some things to do to get his brand out there a little bit more.
For the oxygen water,
For the oxygen water. And on the Saturday night, I messaged him, not really expecting to pick up the message.
Yeah.
Say, look, I got this thing for you, what do you think? My man had the whole team was on the chat on a Saturday night at 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
I went in my little office and I pulled out some old footage from a workout that I had done with Dan and Tom P, which was like a Hyrox workout.
Right.
And that was my first video that I made that people thought was a professional video. I made it in iMovie. It's an old footage. And that was the ad.
Right.
And we had the ad up by the Monday.
Well, because Dr. Mohammed said, you know, we're going to sponsor this, see how this sounds.
Correct.
Cure all the way.
And he took, they basically, that was a Cure pop-up. So there were no other real sponsors on that.
I thank them so much, SMG, for so absolutely. Much for that.
The only other sponsor was Pharmacy Sales, who came in and subsidized the rapid testing for us.
Right.
Thank you. To make sure everybody was safe. And then we were down the road rolling. So, yeah.
Yeah. And it was a success, I would say. Everybody that competed seemed to have had a good time. People, 50-50. People that did the individual loved the individual. Uh-huh. People who did the team loved the team. So I think you're onto something with the Barfit.
That's a permanent in the calendar now.
For sure.
And I think the other thing with Barfit too is that it's such a good spectator event.
Right.
You know,
it's not everything right there in front of you, and you designed it.
It to be a spectator event. We moved the track so if everything starts and finishes right in front of the pavilion, you ain't really got to go nowhere. It's like a sports day.
Yes, it is.
It is like a sports day, right? And the events were it worked out really well with the number of athletes we had because everything was flowing through the day. There were never any big drops in the action. One heat, then the next heat, then the next heat.
Whereas, and then teams.
And you know, Bar is about participation. We always say Bar is not a spectator sport, but we're realizing now that certain parts of Bar are actually really good for watching.
Yeah.
So Barfit Games is one of those. The pop-ups are another good spectator type event. And then, you know, the big bar in November, December is when we get together and everybody's a part of it. And that also is turning into a spectator sport because we see that there are areas in the course where people gather and really want to watch the action because obstacles might be challenging or otherwise.
Yeah, and then you also designing the bar, the big bar, that's where we can start, probably start calling it with the festival zone, and you got this field with all the different obstacles. But speaking of spectator sports, we went across the course one time.
Right, because
last year, and I think doing some things to make it even more spectator friendly this year, last year that was a sight to behold.
Yes, and I mean, I remember like going, because I drove support last year. Yeah. Remember last year, there were teams of five, with the fifth person being the support driver with all the power aid and water, and sorry, not power aid, altitude sports drink and water.
That was last year.
And so on and so forth. And everybody come out of the house, wait, what part we not come from? Bass, enjoy. How we like, man? Yes. And so on and so forth. And last year, with COVID and everything, we let people leave St. John whenever they wanted.
Right.
So some people, you left at 2 o'clock or something, so?
I think we were the third team on the road. We left at 3. We left Tom at 2.
Right. So, so like, people wanted to, it wasn't a competition. It was just a challenge to see if people could do it, how they would feel doing it, and what time they would take. But this time now, we've made it into a little bit of a race event.
Right.
But the thing about these smaller inverted commas events, although I think they're all going to develop a life of their own, is that they're about creating noise around the event. They're about building momentum into the big bar, as you call it, in December. So, yeah, so getting a mass of people on the road at the same time is better for that. And it's better for the sponsors as well. And thanks to Isuzu at Simpson Motors, Automotive Art, Pharmacy Sales, and again, SMJ Beverages for coming on board and helping to support this event.
So, yeah.
In helping to support this event, it means that everybody gets a t-shirt on the road. So you get your t-shirt.
That's a plus.
Yeah, so everybody get a t-shirt. T come out with a hard coast-to-coast logo, Dren.
Yeah.
And my plan was to put everybody in different t-shirts based on team. But I think that logo is going to fly on a white t-shirt. So I think everybody can end up in white t-shirts just because it's going to look better for the logo. The sponsors will have their logos in the back.
See if we can put a logo and see if I could give T some credit. If I can muster some credit for T.
Yeah, you got T. We'll give T a little props for that one.
You're
I posted it on the page today on the stories. Megan, my new member of staff and intern, she's doing sports science at UE. She made a little poster with it. But the logo itself is hard. That's the logo at the top there, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, let's go to the page.
Yeah.
I see. I think you posted the logo itself. No, it was on stories.
It was on the stories, yeah. So we're gonna get everybody a t-shirt. So that's why there's a little entry fee. We can get everybody.
Yeah, guys, the camera for real. Yeah, man, we gotta be utilizing things.
For sure. Everybody gets a t-shirt.
Right. One.
We're able to give some prize money this time because it's a competition. I know there are people out there who feel like, you know, if the prize money ain't big enough, they ain't coming up. But I feel like just having some little incentive to get people interested. I don't feel like these little events need to break the bank. And I don't feel that you even really need money to get people to come out. There'll be so few.
We came out last year for free.
For nothing. And there'll be so
few. Not even get a t-shirt last year.
Right.
Patches.
and again, thanks to Laura Saro and Dean Saro for sponsoring those patches.
Yeah, patches. We know we get shirts and water and sports drinks, but it's entry free.
And now we have the Barbados Police Service on the road as well to make sure that everybody's safe. Because, you know, sometimes Sunday morning there's a lot of traffic going to church and so on, so we want to make sure everybody's safe on the road, so we're putting some resources in it to make sure. And the cost again is the same for it. I'm trying to hit that $40 price point all the way through to all the small events leading up, and if we need to test, that will help to cover some of the testing as well, and the cost will be covered by the sponsors.
Are you going to be doing it in June or is it July?
June 26th is the date we have on the calendar.
I was asking that because, you know, Quapova Fest is going to be started.
Right.
So you're looking at Sunday morning people going to church. You're also looking at Sunday morning people coming home. So having the police with the teams is a good, and a big plus.
Correct.
Good thing and a big plus.
And we looked at the calendar. There's only one thing happening that day. Is can't remember where it is, but it's one little event. You told me.
Powder, yeah.
And
For now.
I mean, obviously.
We're not promoting their event, though.
Right. We even know who that is. So I think this is a good time for it. Everybody will leave around 4 in the morning, 4:30, and by the time we get to town and everybody start to come out of their house, then there'll be the mass of people getting towards the boatyard.
Can you remember how long it took last year? Tom Pitt, they were the fastest. Were they under 4 hours or was it under?
They were just under 4 hours.
Just
I think
under
4 hours,
hours
were their target, and they were just under 4 hours. But I think that this year we're going to see a faster time.
Maybe, because you also don't have the bucket this year.
You don't have the bucket. I mean, the bucket to me, the bucket wasn't really that heavy, but it's difficult to carry.
Yes.
So now having the two sandbags, maybe the heavier sandbag is a challenge.
It will be.
But the light sandbag now is way, way more comfortable than the bucket. And these sandbags, I think, are easier to carry than the other ones because you can actually take your hands off them sometimes. Just drape it over your shoulder, especially the 50-pound one.
Yeah.
And go down the road. So, yeah.
It's going to be a challenge, though, for sure. So is you got the so you might get a faster time, but the average team then finish between 4 and 5 hours.
Correct.
So that means if we're leaving at 4 o'clock, it should be done by 9 o'clock.
Correct. So we should get to the boatyard around 9 o'clock. Then everybody could take a little dip in the ocean. Thanks again to the guys at the boatyard for always accommodating us. They never want anything for it. Yeah, George, you could come through. I'm like, you want to do a little breakfast special? Nah, I got too busy. I got catamaran. I ain't wanting more work. George, right. You're good. Take the place and go long. So yeah, thanks to Sean and Sean Gill and Sean DeFreitas for allowing us to use the space. And I'm looking forward to this event because I think adding a little competitive element to it, you know, makes it, you know, gives it that little edge.
Mm-hmm.
And to be able to, in these times, to be able to give a fella a little $100 prize, a little $200 prize, get some prizes from the sponsors and start to, you know, get some for your work.
Yeah.
I think is a good thing for sure.
I think Course of Course is one of those things that's going to probably be better subscribed this year. So I would advise anyone listening who's even considering it to hit that registration button as soon as possible. Get your team together. People were asking me about teams, finding teams.
Right.
People won't be able to, people may actually break rank with a normal big bar team.
Right.
And just do a Course of Course. But is there anywhere that people can find a team that you can think of other than the bar team finder on Facebook?
I think that's still the best page.
Yeah.
Go to this Barbados Adventure Race Team Fighter on your Facebook and you just go in there and say what you want. But come to some of the trainings, you know, like now for the next little period of time, the Barfit class on a Saturday morning is going to move from Godhill Playing Field and it's going to be training for Barfit for the coast to coast. So I can have the sandbags out there, I can have the logs out there, and we're starting at Bath and we can do little different sections, repeats and so on to build up towards getting, because that's the hardest part of the course.
From Bath to the top of Pothos.
Yeah, but when you get over Pothos, the rest is just, it's just a mental challenge to get down the road.
Just one for the athlete next.
Exactly, but that's rare. That's where men stick up last year.
Yeah.
So I think doing some hill repeats with the carries, getting people stronger for those will really help when we get down to June.
Yeah, okay. It's going to be good. So you said, what's the price point for the $40 per person.
$40 per person. And again, if you have to test, that will include your testing. We'll reach out to pharmacy sales again. If we have to test, that will include your testing and they'll subsidize it. And, you know, big shout out to Gregory Ruck and Rihanna at pharmacy sales because they never say no. They always jump in and support the bar.
Yeah,
for sure.
We just urging. When you hear us talking about all of these sponsors that happen to get bar events to come off, Isuzu, Cure, SMJ, all of their products, Altitude Sports Drinks, begging you to support them as well in our everyday lives. Go by Pega Sunday morning and have breakfast because we want to keep helping them because they continue to help us and help the sport that we love.
Correct. Automotive Art kept coming on this year as well. We've been trying to get them on board for a while. They're our neighbor right across
the road.
And I think it's natural that they were a part of the event, so we got them on board thanks to Jeremy.
I hope they're doing more than bringing spawn and they're bringing tears.
No, they're actually they're supporting us in a big way.
I suspect they would be, man.
So I'm grateful to them as well, for sure.
That is such a natural fit because those guys that lame from Automotive Art also that watch us at classes on evenings when the bar classes are going on, they always got a lot of talk. I feel like Automotive Art should be bringing a team to Big Bar.
I think they should be bringing a team for Coast to Coast. They should be bringing a team for Big Bar and for every little event leading up to it as well, for sure.
Yeah, that man got too much talk over there, man. So Coast to Coast, what else you want to get over there about Coast to Coast?
Well, register early because like you said, we're going to cap the numbers. I said 25 teams, but you know, if we get closer, we got 20, I might shut it down. So don't wait till the last moment, because I saw this on the Barfit Games.
Mm-hmm.
People were like, hey, I talking to so and so about a team, and this boy can do it next, and this boy can do it third. And it was a Thursday, and I had two spaces left.
For teams.
And I know that there were teams out there that had been talking and talking and talking, teams that you would have expected to actually be, you know, in the running for prizes, and they hadn't even registered yet.
Right.
And one of those teams was actually Outdoor Fitness.
Really?
Up until the Thursday, they Tompy and them, they down there still making sport, doing nonsense. The other one was the Barbies. The Barbies still on the Thursday, I guess they figured they know they were coming in, they would enter when they're ready. So I had to message them and say, look, I got two spaces left. If y'all really want this thing, go and enter now because I'm shutting it down.
Shutting off, And the thing is that you can't, like, I know that everybody says, we're a family and George this and George that, but You got to control the implements. You got to know how much atlas stones you carry in that go ahead. You got how many sandbags.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. No atlas. You mean for the Barfit games? Yeah.
And
obviously for coast to coast.
There's
a lot of stuff to take down to Bath Beach, but also like the police want to know how many people on the road.
Right.
The attorney general want to know how many people in this event. The COVID monitoring unit has a certain number that they're comfortable with.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to do anything at all to jeopardize the relationship we have with them, because if it weren't for them, we would have been able to pull off all these events in the last couple of years. So whatever they tell me to do, they're doing to the letter. And if they say only 20 teams, it's 20 teams, so don't wait to the last minute. Get registered as soon as possible. We got a few teams registered already.
Yeah, 20 teams is 20 sandbags red, 20 sandbags green, and 20 logs as well.
20 logs, correct.
Yeah, so yeah. So how the sponsorship at Isuzu work? Can you say how many vehicles they're going to have on the road with us?
Yeah, so I'm saying 5 at the moment, but it could be more. Mm-hmm. And then Automotive Art will also have some vehicles on there. So there's going to be the vehicle at the front, which is leading the way, the vehicle at the back, which will obviously be with the last team, and then vehicles will be leapfrogging each other in between, and they'll have the water, they'll have the sports drinks, they'll have some fruit, they'll have the energy bars, and they'll have medical on those vehicles, so that at any point in time there will be vehicles close to you on the way that you could stop and get your supplies from your team.
But having a specific place that you say, like at the top of Green Hill, you've got a vehicle park at the Parish Church, St. George Parish Church, right there by that corner, may go a vehicle there.
Exactly.
Like that.
We're going to try to space them like 3 kilometers and have them leapfrog each other. So every 3 kilometers from here to here, you'll find another vehicle waiting for you, and so on and so forth.
That's good.
Plus, obviously, we'll be on radios in case anybody gets into trouble. You can run back and get them.
Nice. This is something like this is going to be an epic event once again this year. And what I loved about it last year is, I said, when we started to get towards, the further you go, the more populated it becomes. Because everything you're coming out of St. John Bath is no one.
Correct.
You get to the top of Green Hill, there's no one. But the time you get to the top of Pothole Hill, people might not be waking up, but they're not really looking out. Then you've got this long stretch all along, like Lemonade Bante. Now, as you start to descend then from, let's say, the church, the same church, you get down one McGun Hill and you start to come down to Charles River Bridge at Salters.
Right.
But then with the sun coming up, Barbados waking up, people looking out and seeing all these people walking with these obstacles, these implements. You start to ask questions, and it's probably going to be a huge spectacle because
and people come out line the roads because people can't believe all these foolish people doing this nonsense.
It's going to be different this year because I remember last year we had different starting times, so
it was more spread out.
Yeah, the tourists and the people you see pass here with a long the bill at the curve. If you see 5-6 teams, and they suspect if you get a good set of entries, you're going to have 5 or 6 teams that are going to be in sight of each other.
Correct.
It might not be a striking distance, but in sight. Then for sure you can get people coming out and laying in the road and all their support.
For sure, and I'm really looking forward to it. I think that this event is an event that has so much potential to grow. I mean, I'm trying to keep, while we're still in this little bit of a COVID thing, we're trying to keep the numbers manageable. But as time goes on, this could be huge, huge, huge for sure.
Yeah, man. So it's coast to coast. We've talked about Barfit. The last thing we have to talk on today, in this podcast today, is the 24-hour race, George, man.
Yeah.
I mean, I stay minimal convincing to do a bar event. Remember last year, coast to coast, everybody in the group was like, man, George, man, I know. They was like, we can do this.
We did. We ain't complain, but we got to do it.
Yeah, we ain't complain, but we saw it. We were at Barfit Games, same thing. It was like, George, let me run this to the car. You know what? Yeah. Tig even said the other day, anything that George come up with salt is born to.
Right.
No, I got my reservations about this 24-hour race, George.
Right.
I mean that you continue to push the limit.
Right.
Where it coming from, where it going, convince me to do it.
So I think when people hear a 24-hour race, they feel that each individual has to run for 24 hours.
Right.
And I think the only person that we have on island that might really be looking to do something like that is Ali Allen. Ali Allen is the ultra endurance event specialist that does bar.
Yeah.
But no, it is a relay.
Right.
So at first I was saying, let's make it really manageable for people by making it teams of 5. But I think it's easier to find teams of 4, and people will probably want to stay with the kind of, the big bar teams.
Right.
So it'll be teams of 4. And it doesn't mean that you have to run continuously for the 24 hours.
Not even as a team.
No, you run individually, right? So I run a lap, I come back, I hand off my chip to you. You run a lap, you come back, you hand off your chip to the next person, and so on and so forth. And it doesn't have to be sequential. You might decide that you feel good and you rather run 2 laps.
Mm-hmm.
And if we get to a point where it's like 9 o'clock at night and you say, look, You're tired, I'm tired. Let me lay down here for 2 or 3 hours and sleep, and then get back up from midnight and run through till 4 o'clock in the morning, and then call it a day. Right. It's really how many laps you feel to do within the 24-hour period. It doesn't have to be constant. One person doesn't have to, you know, keep moving. You could decide what you want to do as a team. Some teams might decide, look, you might do a little math test, and you might say, look, let me try and aim for 20 laps and then call it a day.
Right.
Let me try and aim for 30. Everybody, like I always say, in bar, you create your own podium. So everybody will have.
You all seem looking at George trying to be convinced.
So like if you're running, by later on, you might be walking. But let me say you might run a lap every 3 hours.
Yeah.
You know, and then you might say, let me take an hour off and run another lap. You can find 5K every 4 hours or so. And only to make it look like bar. 4 foot wall. I mean, a 4 foot wall, you step over a 4 foot wall, crawl under the farm table. So I think this is going to be exciting. I know that for sure. There are people who are even more excited about the 24 hour race than they are about coast to coast. But I think that, you know, again, 20 teams, and the way it's going to be structured is that we're going to use
it for 80 people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
we're going to use the campsite at Peg as kind of the quiet area rest zone.
Mm.
So you can set up your tent there. Your registration fee will be the same, $40. And half of that is going to go towards your campsite place at Peg. Bring up your tent, set up your tent, chill out, relax when you're not running, get some rest. And then the main chip, the baton takeover as it were, is going to be just where we did the Amarone 5K last time, right in front of everything, in the middle of the action.
Yeah.
So that'll be your start point and finish point for the loop. The loop is very similar to the 5K trail mix, except that we don't go down Bowling Alley.
A lot of people are asking about that in the running groups as well.
Yeah, so we're not going down Bowling Alley, we just loop around, and I found the extra distance on the other side of Peg.
Okay, and you said that would lead you on over to, that's Hackleton's
Cliff? Yeah, closer to Hackleton's Cliff, exactly. Okay. Yeah. So just ran around one of the fields on there, Malvern, and that gives us the extra 800 meters or whatever we needed, and it works out almost exactly to 5K.
Okay. How are you tracking that people do the tables and the 4 foot wall?
Well, we can try and get some volunteers, but trying to get volunteers over a 24-hour period is going to be kind of hard. I mean, you could walk around the 4 foot wall, but I mean, I don't expect people to cheat.
Right.
You know, we might just put up a little GoPro there or whatever. The prize money is never really enough that it's worth your integrity.
worth your integrity
to teeth for $250.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, you know, if it was $25,000, maybe, but it ain't worth your integrity. And this is not, I don't think that in general, that's the barbarian spirit neither.
Right.
So, you know, let me come out, let me make it a fun event, let me make it a festival type atmosphere. We're gonna have music playing the whole day and night.
Uh-huh.
It'll be a lime. Starbucks is coming on board, so there'll be a
we
Starbucks.
We need that. There. We need that's a good sponsor.
Starbucks will be there as well. I got some beer brands and alcohol brands coming. You can have a little beer, nothing hard, you know?
Yeah.
And turn it into a little festival, especially, and that I had a date specifically chosen for that event.
Right.
Because I wanted to give people a little break from Kadumin and push it towards the end of August. But I spoke to Paul, and Paul said, but what happened, you choose that date? That's a full moon?
Uh-huh.
And I was like, jeez, all right.
But that obvious, going to mention full moon?
That obvious, so it has to be on a full moon night.
And yes.
The moon is going to be at its brightest on the 13th of August at 7:30 p.m.
2022.
Mm-hmm. So we've moved the date. You'll get updates after Coast to Coast. But let me focus on Coast to Coast for now.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just a little hint for those people who are scared. It is a relay. So you don't have to worry about running for 24 hours on your own.
But you exchange your chip by the start finish line.
Correct. As you pass over the sensor, you hand the baton. In this case, the baton is the chip. Body put on the chip, and they move and go.
Okay, so that would just need for some organizing with the team. You know, if you're running the next leg, you should really move towards the start finish zone now.
Correct.
Okay. Yeah, for sleeping.
Exactly. Yeah. So that whole team strategy is going to be something that's interesting. People will work out their own thing, but yeah, that's kind of how we plan to run it.
Composition of the teams?
I think it's going to be, let's say, the usual bar composition, but at least two females. So if we want to have an all female team, that could happen for this event as well, because it's always harder to find the females.
Yeah.
And
all male team definitely will not be in it for the points or the prize money.
No, again, if you want to compete as an all male team, you could come and do it as your own personal challenge, but you wouldn't be eligible for the prizes.
Right. Fair enough. That sounds good. And I feel like any all male teams too will also have to. If they get team, if another team coming on, and I say, all right, you can't come in.
Right. Exactly. That was what I had said in the little brief I said. So if we, yeah. We're going to give preference to the teams.
Preference, that is the word I'm looking for.
Yeah. Teams that are constituted in normal bar legal fashion.
Yeah.
But if we have, you know, if we only get 18 of them and we got 7 all-male teams or 3 male, 1 female that want to do it, we'll allow them to do it. They just won't be eligible for the prizes.
So start hunting people. Start looking out for the runners. Look for the people that you know love running. And ask them if they're going to do it and see if you can get on the team. That's the best way to find a team for the 24 hours. And that's the thing about these events now, because you're going now, the bar fit was balanced. That was a balanced event.
Right.
Course to course now, yeah, it's a lot of endurance, but you got some strength in this. And this one now, the 24 hour, which I still haven't been named yet.
I haven't named it yet. I'm trying to find a catchy name for it. Right now, it's just the bar 24 hour challenge, but we got to do better than that.
Yeah. I can't tell you what I was thinking.
Right.
Yeah, but yeah, it should be fun, man. I'm looking forward to all of the events. And I know for sure it's a packed calendar. So that's June and August. Are you going to leave out July?
Yeah, we're going to leave out Kaduma month and let people enjoy themselves a little bit. We don't want to compete with, especially the people not having had one for 2 years.
Yeah.
So we think that there's going to be too many people looking for crop over events. So just let people enjoy themselves. Train for bar. Get the body for the road, and then come back after that and train for and do 24 hour race, and then we go down the road to December.
I hope all want to go there and lose all in the form. All right, guys, that's it for the Barcast podcast. I'm Salt,
and I'm George.
Tell us what you liked about it. Tell us what you hated about it. Well, no, don't tell me. I'm sensitive. Tell George what you hated about it, and keep the feedback coming, because you're trying to make this bigger and better each and every time, just like Bar.
All right, I think that is good.
Yeah.
Stop.
Make sure I save.
You start, right?
Yeah.
File, save project as?
Yeah.
Save it. You want me to send it to you, right?
You're going to save it, you're going to export the MP3 and send it.
Oh, so save project is not an audio file.
Yeah, let's get okay for that. Yeah.
You need to
stop the camera recording too.
Yeah.